2 years ago, we founded Asta Alliance with a vision to raise awareness about the eight Indian classical dance forms. Since then, our vision has evolved and it has become a lot more concrete. This has allowed us to host meaningful events, such as today's conference, which is aimed at facilitating a dialogue about the different aspects of the Nāṭyaśāstra and how it is presently practiced and interpreted. This conference was a brainchild of the Indian Classical Music Society of Vancouver and Asta Alliance, and it also happens to be our first collaboration. And I hope not the last one. But it truly has only become possible with the support of all our wonderful panelists, sponsors and partners, and of course, all our wonderful audience members. Thank you, Dr. Anne Murphy, for all your support as the director of the Center of South Asia Research, and Akhil for spearheading this conference. I hope that Asta Alliance and ICMSB can collaborate to bring more such diverse events and programming to the community. Thank you once again, and I hope you all enjoy the conference.
Thank you. Today's panel talk, Bharata's Nāṭyaśāstra and its impact on Shastra and Prayoga, is a continuation of Bose's lecture and looks at bringing musicians, dancers, and scholars in a dialogue on the intersections of theory and practice. So today's panel is going to be moderated both by Dr. Bose and Dr. Hunter. So I'm just going to introduce everybody on the table from my left to my right. So Dr. Thomas Hunter is a lecturer in Asian Studies at the University of British Columbia, where he teaches the first 2 years of study of the Sanskrit language and elective courses on South and Southeast Asian history, literature, and culture. He practices Hindustani classical music as a serious avocation and a practice of mindfulness. He began his training in the instrumental and vocal traditions of the Sanya Mehar lineage of Hindustani music in 1970, under Ustad Ali Akbar Khan Saab at his college in San Rafael, California, and continues to find inspiration in the memory of the master and his music. Welcome, Dr. Hunter.
Thank you.
Shri Arijit Mahalanabis began his studies in music under vocalist Srimati Shahana Banerjee of Delhi shortly before his family moved from India to the US. Faced with few options for formal study, Arijitji undertook an intense period of self-directed study, encouraged and supported by his mother, Srimati Shukla Mahalanobis. Starting in 1989, he began a long association with Penn State University's Vancouver. In 1999, he moved to Seattle and began a diligent period of discipleship under Srimati Shanta Benegal, a vocalist and musicologist versed in Dagar Bani, Dhrupad, Khayal, and Dhrupad. He has performed across the states at various venues, including the Cornish College of the Arts, and after serving as an adjunct in adjunct positions at the Evergreen State College and the University of Washington, in 2008, Arijitji found his true calling as a teacher of music when he established the Seattle Indian Music Academy, SIMA. In 2014, after 15 years in Seattle, he relocated to State College and is presently helping to establish a new SIMA, the Society for Indian Music and Arts, in his old hometown. I'm also very privileged to have him as my guru. So please welcome Guruji Arijit Mahalanobis. Dr. Lakshmi Sreeram is a performer of the two major traditions of Indian art music, the North Indian Hindustani and the South Indian Carnatic. Lakshmiji holds a PhD in philosophy from the University of Bombay. Her PhD thesis was in the area of literary theory in the Sanskrit tradition of Alankara Shastra. She has been a guest faculty at IIT Madras and is also a freelance writer. She has contributed articles on matters cultural to First Post regularly and also the Hindu and Tribune. Lakshmiji has been awarded the Fulbright Nehru Professional and Academic Excellence Fellowship 2019 to 2020. She is attached to the College of Music, Colorado University Boulder, where she will be teaching improvisation in Indian music, as well as researching improvisation in jazz. And thankfully, due to this association this year, we've been very lucky to bring her here to Vancouver. One of Lakshmiji's current projects is to put together an online course on rasa, an aesthetic theory, in which she will present the development of the theory of rasa in the Sanskrit tradition of the Alankara Shastra. Please welcome Dr. Lakshmi Sreeram. And we already have been introduced to Dr. Bose, and her lecture, I think, spoke volumes as to the knowledge that she brings to this panel discussion today, but please welcome her again. Srimati Sudnya Mulye is a professional Bharatanatyam dancer, choreographer, and instructor. She holds her BFA in Bharatanatyam and MFA in choreography from the Nalanda Nidritya Kala Mahavidya, University of Mumbai, India. She has studied under the great masters Guru Ji Sondha Idarajaha and Srimati Tangamani, Padma Shri Dr. Kanak Rere, and Padma Bhushan Srimati Kalanidhi Narayanan, Guru Lata Raman. Sudnya Ji has performed at various festivals in India and has won the Shringar Mani title in 1996 and was selected as a graded artist of Mumbai Television. Sudnya Ji also performed in Nritya Bharati, a television serial about seven classical dance styles in India, and in 2018 was awarded for her work at the Sangeet Marthan Pandit Ram Marathi Smriti Samaroha in her hometown in India. Sudnya Ji has spent the last 20 years cultivating the appreciation of Bharatanatyam through teaching, choreography, artistic direction, and collaboration, and through the establishment of the Sudnya Dance Academy. Please welcome Srimati Prajakta Trehan started learning Kathak at the age of 4 from Sri Mulla Sir and continued under the tutelage of the late Guru Srimati Asha Zodhlekar, the founder of Archana Nrityalaya, Mumbai. Prajakta Ji was trained in the nuances of Jaipur, Benares, and Lucknow Ghananas of Kathak. Throughout her training years, she has won many trophies and accolades in dance competitions and has performed in a variety of dance ballets in India and Singapore. She was titled as Shringar Mani in 2004 by Sur Singar Samiti. Besides being a kindergarten teacher here, Prajakta Ji has a business graduate degree from India and has a master's degree in Kathak from the Akhil Bharatiya Gandharva Mahavidyalaya in Mumbai. She is the founder of Nidhyanjali Kathak Dance Academy in Surrey, which promotes Kathak and Indian folk dances. Prajakta Ji has choreographed and presented her senior students, as well as performed herself at prestigious venues in Vancouver, such as the Nāṭyaśāstra Festival, Mushtari Begum Festival, and Surrey Festival of Dance. Please welcome Prajakta Ji. I'd like to now hand off the panel to Dr. Bose and Dr. Hunter for moderation.
I would think that a lot of people have addressed number 14. Shall we go there?
Yes, sure.
Because I see four people have, or three. Is generating rasa through your performance a major deal for you?
Absolutely, I guess, whether it's Bharatanatyam or any classical dance style, rasa is very important. Rasa. As we also heard you this morning, if anyone performs, from my experience of performing, rather learning, performing and teaching, the core of performance, but the core of dance is presenting with rasa. Now, when we perform and we talked about nrutta and nrutya, different words, we don't, as teachers, we don't go, or as performers, when we perform or choreograph, we don't think with the words written in Nāṭyaśāstra, but what we take is the essence of Nāṭyaśāstra. And that essence is about presenting rasa. Now, whether it's a pure dance piece or it is an abhinaya piece, even when your movements do not describe any story or any words, if you do not have the connection with the beats or with the music that's being played in today's world, it would rather look, as what I tell my students, quite robotic. And I think that's where the rasa word is very important. And I remember since childhood listening to these words, listen to the music, understand the music. And I think I never understood as a child what it is, but as along the way, what I've understood is, if I can't listen or hear what the singer is singing or what the drum beats are playing, I don't think I can connect with my movements. I cannot really represent what they're playing, because sometimes they could be playing quite soft beats. And if I'm going to just stomp my feet in the largest sound, it may not create the same effect. And that effect is what becomes rasa in nrutta or pure dancing. And absolutely, when it comes to storytelling part of it, which becomes abhinaya, every detail of words need to be understood by every artist, every student. We start off with very basic, you know, every student in Bharatanatyam would know angikam bhuvanam yasya. But what is really angikam? What is really bhuvanam? And what does even yasya mean? It is just yasya, or is it really connected to believing in it? So people might do actions with knowing the names of the hand gestures or knowing where it should be placed. You know, this is the right position for it. But have you really understood the word yasya that even takes you to the further word, angikam bhuvanam yasya vachikam sarvavangmaya? So where does this first two words end in yasya, and then how do you go further? So every word for a dancer becomes important, and I think that's where the rasa generation is initiated right from the day the student or a dancer begins her journey on this learning of dance, or rather practicing the dance.
Want to comment on one thing. We talked about that Bharata's idea, nritya doesn't have any rasa,
yeah,
only beauty.
Yes.
So nritya you can connect, but has been debated by everybody. So.
And I think the beauty word itself, what our teachers talked it as rasa. They would explain us in such a way that, you know, if you have a fake smile, the movement doesn't come through in the right way. In their own way, as our teachers not always had the book that they followed, they would explain, I need to see your inner smile, that's what they would say. And I think that's where the beauty element, then they started connecting to the word.
It's a long debate.
It's absolutely a long debate.
Hear from other people. How would you?
Sure, I can go. So for me, very simply put, in layman's term, is when I cook for my family, what is the goal? Is the goal just to feed the family, or is it for them to enjoy the food that's made for them? Will they feel satiated? It's just, is it making them only full? Or is it for them to have an aftertaste of what I made for them? And that is my goal as an artist when I dance on stage. It's not just making sure I performed and my audience saw my performance. It is making sure that my audience left with the essence of my performance. They understood, but they also enjoyed to a level of the uccha koti, to the most extreme of enjoyment, where very recently we saw Partha performing Bharatanatyam. And I was just talking to my student today, even today, 2 months later, when I close my eyes, I can still feel how he showed the flower being jealous because Krishna's face touched the bee. And he just showed with a hand how the flower was jealous, and then he looked at the flower and he touched again and the flower came alive. If I today, 3 months later, can close my eyes and still experience the same pleasure, that is rasa nirmit. It is not what you experience today only. It is what you take home with you. It is what you could close your eyes and still feel. And that is my goal as an artist. And that is what we have learned. Yes, we learned the text. We did understand, read the words. But the meaning of the text came only, it's still a learning process. It has not really, I have not really understood the true meaning unless I keep experiencing it myself and I practice to give you the experience. So for me, creating rasa, feeling it, and recreating it and feeling it back is very important in my performance. I would speak personally for that.
No, the musicians.
So, you know, any art form, whether it's music or dance or a piece of poem or a painting, there is something that we can speak of as transcending just the elements of presentation. The way the elements come together, and that is one of the aspects of rasa, that the various elements of a presentation come together. And a kind of transformation happens. You know, I want to evoke the analogy or the metaphor of the Alata Chakra that Abhinav Gupta talks about. That you see, you have Alata Chakra is a torch, the burning torch, and when you swirl it, right, you can see a circle. If you get into a certain rhythm, you can create it, a circle is created. But that circle is actually an illusion. You don't have a circle. You only have various points where the flame has been. Now, similarly, in art or performance or any other kind of art, we have various elements, right? And the challenge, the artistic challenge, is to present it or to bring it together in such a way that those elements just come together magically and create another level of experience. So in that sense, if you talk of rasa, I would say, yes, music or dance, it is very true. But, you know, the rasa theory is not just a theory of, you know, how you feel or what you take away or the lingering sense of the experience. It is a very specific theory. And many say it is applicable in Natya and in literature. Because if you talk of vibhava, anubhava, vibhichari bhava, it's very specific. You know, in the case of music, for instance, when you're doing raga, vibhava, anubhava simply don't apply. It's not... in dance, it does. In Bharatanatyam, for example, if you present a sanchari, which is a very important aspect of the varna, so you describe a lady waiting for her love, the naika waiting for her love, you may show her as, you know, shringara, you may show her as dressing up. So all that is, you know, those are all conditions that evoke the emotion of love. And then she may go out and look for him and she may feel dejected. Or she may think about something, or maybe he's with somebody else. So you have doubt, you have depression. These are all various vibhichari bhavas that come to feed the basic emotion of love. So that is essentially what rasa as a presentation of emotion involves. That you depict a certain basic emotion, the sthayi bhava, using various elements, fed by various other conflicting emotions even, and how that comes out. And for Bharata, the challenge for him, for any person producing a natya, was how do you create that Alata Chakra? How do you create? And that Alata Chakra experience is rasa. So in that very specific sense, I wouldn't say as a musician, I think of rasa. I think of the raga. That's hard enough. And hard enough and abstract enough. You know, it is abstract, raga. And while singing raga, just there are so many elements, so many aspects that we have to take care of, so many places where we can slip up and, you know, mess up. You have the sur, you know, just the pitch, the notes, the phraseology, how you bring out the raga. And if you you know, if you try to present a raga, there are other ragas lurking in various corners. You know, you want to, and you want to do it without being petrified, you know. Mm. If I'm singing Marva, oh my God, am I going to get Puriya here? If that's your, how you approach the presentation, it's going to fall flat. You should have, you know, in that sense, you know, rasa, one of the debates in, you do have a time limit, can you just go on for a couple of
minutes? Yeah, just, yeah, because we have to go through all those.
Yeah.
Go ahead, make
yeah.
it brief.
Okay. Yeah. So,
what's the goal?
Yeah. So, for me, when I sing, I have the raga in my heart. I want to bring out the raga. And in many ways, there are parallels with rasa. Raga and rasa itself, there are many parallels. So I think I will pass it on to Arijit Ji with this.
Well, you've left me in a difficult spot, I must say, Lakshmi Ji. Because what I would say is, the parallel between raga and rasa, I think the parallel goes beyond being independent structures. What I mean by that is that in a particular raga, for example, Maru and Puri, as you were talking about just a second ago, it's not just the phraseology or the juxtaposition of notes that will suggest or not suggest one particular raga. If I hold a particular note at a particular frequency, my sense is that it produces a bhava. Mm. And if I produce a bhava, automatically there is a pathway to rasa. Now the understanding, of course, is that it is not contextual. When I'm singing Puriya, I'm not necessarily painting a picture of a particular story, right? I'm not suggesting viraha. I'm not suggesting Shringara. Whatever one might suggest in a more concrete sense in a dance form or in a Natya setting, but a particular note does evoke a certain emotion in a human being in the context that it is produced. And therefore one can argue that even independent of specific meaning, one can produce a sense of rasa. And that sense of rasa comes from your own personal experience and how you perceive the note that is being produced. So what I would like to suggest is that this is why I asked you the question that I asked you right after your talk. What I'd like to suggest is that, in fact, one can model rasa, one can model bhava quite independently of meaning, of concrete storytelling. One can definitely model it on the basis of the notes and the juxtaposition of the notes and the particular shruti that one is holding of a note in a raga. So that's what I think. Is that fair?
I'll just add to that that when I studied music, it was from the late Ali Akbar Khan, our Guruji, starting in 1970. And I was always aware that he was very deeply invested in rasa, and he felt that he should explain at least the basics of the rasa for most ragas, although not always and not every time he sat down. But when he did, it was often profound, and it had, you know, he was very invested in the idea that these ragas have powers, and they have rasa. And from time to time, he would show particular aspects of that. I made a few recordings last night, and my tape recorder didn't work, so maybe I can demonstrate those in a little bit. But what I'm interested in now is the relationship of tonality and rasa, and how that was explored, particularly in the music of my guru, whose music I know best. And I think there is a relationship. One of the other things I observed about him is that he was a very innovative composer and musician, and sometimes he was criticized because he created dozens of new ragas, and not all of them were totally successful, but some were so spectacularly successful that people have forgotten that he composed them. One is Chandranandan. He composed it, he told us, and he's also in his biography, that he went to Air India. He was the main player for Lucknow, and he knew that there was someone there who knew everything. And he went, and the gentleman said, play something new. And something came out, and it was a combination. He didn't know what it was, actually, until a week or two later when everyone was raving about it and saying, what is this raga? And he realized, what, it's a combination of Chandrakos, Nandakos, what's the other one, Malkos, and Koshi Kanara. But it's not just those ragas. And he realized he'd have to work on it, and he tells us that. He worked on it for years and years and years. And it progressively got more and more distinctly Chandranandan. But that was one of the great successes. And others, like Gauri Manjari, nobody plays them. Only Nikhil Banerjee ever dared to play Gauri Manjari. It's too musically advanced. And I don't think that audiences understand quite yet that he was ahead of his time. And, but the other thing I wanted to mention about it was, I think he thought of this kind of musical process as a way of thinking. Because he created a raga called Medhavi, which means intelligence. It's a gorgeous raga, and it's very hard to learn because you have to know at least four other ragas and not slip into them completely. But it's all about the thought process that goes into creating the tonalities of a musical piece, which is what raga is about. We have some guidelines, we have vadi sambadi, but we don't really yet have a language about tonality specifically for Indian music, and I'm hoping we can do that in the future. What's the next one?
Well, I was thinking of, can we try, does a performance react upon all viewers in the same way? Because this, you talked about Ali Akbar Khan. And now, you liked it because you are immersed in it. How do you see that it resonates that same way?
Well, one thing he said several times was, if you play one note absolutely perfectly, it'll touch everyone and they won't even know it. So the point is that if you find that beautiful tonality that you're seeking for in certain the ragas, and you find those combinations in a perfect way, the audience will get it, he felt. I think it's a lot easier if the audience has some background. And yeah. we don't yet have a Bernstein who gets on the TV every Saturday morning and gives kids instructions on how to understand music, but we really should for Indian music, because it's not really that well known. I mean, how many people really know the difference between Kafi Kanara and straight coffee or Zilla coffee? I mean, it's not very well known, but a musician is aware of these things and getting the enjoyment. And as one of you pointed out, you have to be very, Lakshmiji pointed out, you have to be very careful. We were always taught, well, in this raga, you can touch that other raga, but not too much. Right, because you destroy the raga you're working on. So there's all this cross knowledge, and it would help if we had more public education, I think, by musicians and dancers about what's going on.
I can tell you about my experience when I visited Gurukul. There, Kutiyattam is being performed, Kathakali, I saw night after night from 6 to 6. And all the villagers who attended, they could understand the hand gestures. That helps. So the performer, I mean, ideally, the viewers, there should be a kind of, connection. And then only the rasa can be produced. It's a hard and thing that we cannot achieve all the time, seldom, rather, only a few. But we try, and you are going to play your sarod for a little bit for us, and let us see how you can bring on to rasa. Would you like to do that, or should we just go on discussing?
What's the next question? I do want to play a few things, but I should make it appropriate to the question.
Okay, how is rasa generated?
Oh, okay.
A simple one.
All right. Well, this is simple one. Okay. Two ragas that I've been working on for demonstration purposes that I will actually try to make a recording. They're so different. One of them is Sri Rag, which is to be played as the last afternoon raga before sunset, and so it's a very fiery raga. It has a sharp four, which is considered a very hot, fiery note in Indian music and has, I think, three shrutis in the classical definition that we followed. But it's very unusual. Vadi Samvadi in Indian music is based on relationships of fourths or fifths. Every raga has a vadi and a samvadi, which are spaced a fourth or a fifth apart. Well, the fourth and the fifth are major intervals, and they don't change. However, in Sri Raga, the fourth is an augmented fourth. And this brings in the whole history of dissonance in the study of Western music. Western music was very slow to accept certain tonalities. And one of those, amazingly enough, was the fifth. In early church music, it was said that the fifth is the work of the devil. And that's because it's slightly dissonant. I can't hear the dissonance at all, because as music evolved, people became more used to more dissonant intervals. And the fifth was originally. Now the fourth, the augmented fourth, is called in Western music, in classical music, is called the tritone. It's also known as the devil's tone. And it was forbidden because it was too far up on the scale of musical partials to be easily accessible. And people heard it as a dissonance. Well, in Indian music, it's not dissonant at all, but it has a certain powerful effect that you have to learn to control. And this raga is one of the only ragas that has the tritone as its vadi samvadi, which means it's working on the principle of tension in music. That interval is a tense interval. No matter how you cut it, it's still tense. It has to be resolved to a fifth or back to the sa, to the C, in order to feel like you've completed things. So it has built into it a lot of tension. And Baba Ali Akbar had some very specific ideas about this raga. He said, for one thing, that it's the raga that is played by a powerful man when he becomes sad, because you have to, it's a very vir raga. It has a lot of heroism in it. It has heroism and pathos and devotion. That was his description. The interesting thing is that the minor second, which has in Indian, in Sri Raga, it should be both como and ati como. So you're moving back and forth between a minor second and what's called what's it called? It's called the small minor second. So in Western classical analysis, you have the major second, the minor second, and the small minor. You're supposed to move back and forth between those in an undulant motion to create karuna, pathos. But that's only true in the middle and lower registers. In the higher registers, you really have to play it vir, the same note, but it has to be played with a lot of solidity because it's very strong. And if you miss it, it's really agonizing. So I wanted to try to show you what it sounds like to play a few of these notes. First thing is that when you tune your saroh, you're already tuning in the whole idea of the raga. Calcutta style sarod or Sandhya style sarod has three pegs here called Jorda pegs, or for the Jorda strings, and they're not actually played, but they set the major tones for the rag.
I can turn it on from here.
Yeah, why don't you do that? I don't know what's wrong with it.
You're in C sharp?
No, C. Major third.
Good. I just wanted to ask all these participants, so after my lecture, do you think, or from the beginning, this exercise on knowing more about Nāṭyaśāstra has been useful enough in generating rasa, or in general, you want to know, go in depth to knowing what was happening? And we all try to discuss or develop on the theory of rasa, but it's such an abstruse idea. Unless you reach there, it's very difficult to sort of describe. But we all have that goal, like he tried to create some kind of either pathos or, you know, vira rasa, energetic rasa. But let me ask you first, how do you feel? How useful was this exercise of my talking on the Nāṭyaśāstra? Did it give you anything more than what you already knew?
I think after your talk, I shared my thought with Mandakranta ji that I've been living here for more than 20 years now. Sorry. I've been living here for more than 20 years, and as part of my Nalanda training, which is a dance college affiliated to Mumbai University, I think back then when I was studying, I studied in detail as much as a student can understand what Nāṭyaśāstra plays a big role and how Nāṭyaśāstra plays a role in learning Bharatanatyam, or Kanak Ben, who is a great exponent of Mohiniyattam. And she always talked about Mohiniyattam and Bharatanatyam relation and how deeply it goes in this art form while what happens. And I would like to share that, you know, how after 20 years, I actually felt I'm not that student anymore. I can actually understand. And it's a good feeling because you don't really get a chance to talk about it all the time, particularly knowing how Vancouver or we live in the west coast of Canada. You don't get that opportunity to talk about Nāṭyaśāstra, understand Nāṭyaśāstra. So you start teaching, you start understanding the backgrounds over here, and you, in somewhat way, start diluting it. You touch base to it, but you describe it in a simplest way. And I think just by having this dialogue, and a few students, a few dancers, a few artists who are here, hopefully we can take it back. You know, when we go back, we leave out of this room, this day ends, we can take this treasure with us and say, like, no, this is a possibility. And I would like to share how we started learning, and which I've shared with my students. I've treasured that journal. We used to call it journal, and Kanak Ben was very strict on it. And I would need your help a little bit. This is a book that every student had to carry. And it's very interesting. We had pictures drawn on one side with pada bhedas and everything, and even head movements and eye movements. On one side, we wrote definitions written in Nāṭyaśāstra as well as in Abhinaya Darpanam. And right away, a dancer would know if I'm following Nāṭyaśāstra, or some places would I like to think about Abhinaya Darpanam. At the end, back then, I'm talking really years ago. Can you help me a little bit? You know, we joined all these papers together. Now, they're really in pieces, which I hopefully one day can. Or maybe, Mandakranta, you can help me. Here. This is how we learned. And if you look at it, it talks about, the papers are coming about. We went through every possible...
Bhava, and I see... Yes. All the Abhinayas.
Abhinaya, how it was taught. Maybe you can hold and I can read, if that helps. Yes, I have to be really careful. And it started off with Sthayi Bhava of each rasa, moving on to Vyabhichari Bhava, then the Drushti Bheda, the Nasa Bheda, even the nostrils and everything, and all the way to Karanas. So if one rasa was taught to us, Kanak Ben made a point that I had to understand every detail in that rasa. And she made us memorize all the words, but also follow those words, which was technically hard, but we did sit down. And I remember hours and hours, we all would sit down and literally try to bring each Vyabhichari Bhava as what she expected. Now imagine the muscle memory you get through it. Forget about your mind. The sattvika is beyond that. But the muscle memory that you create, like if I know Shrungara, if I have to perform Shrungara in a particular song, you have to go through all these details. And then you get scared for a moment. How do I do this? And I think this is where you know, your lecture, or like what I learned, is it's important to know, but with your experience, and that's where gurus come in. You need to nurture yourself every moment. You cannot be saying, you know, I've got my degrees, job done. The real learning began after my master's, where I had to now put all these words together to understand how do I really use it for performance, and how do I make it simple for my students, because they're not going to go 9 to 5 to learn in detail all details. And I think the other book I would like to share is Kalani Dimami, okay. And that is Abhinaya Aspects. Beautiful books, you should read, understand, experience, if that kind of explains a little bit.
Okay, I think we should sort of try,
yes,
to
make it short.
Be very, very brief. And you started talking about Alankara Shastra, right? I mean, at least as I understood, rasa in that perspective, which is different from actually, you know, music and dance. So was this kind of discussion, or, you know, my presentation, of any use for people like who are performing, who are performers, singers, like you, how useful was it? If it is useful, then we can take it from there and go on further. But if it's just a kind of academic exercise, maybe we should not.
This is my concern, that yes, as you say, I have been engaged with the rasa, dhwani, and all that.
Yeah,
many
yeah. Years.
Continuing
all
my studies. Yeah. Not very deeply. I'm not an academic. I'm not a professional academic. Anyway, but this thing is there. This interest has, you know, occupied my mind. And from your demonstration, Shri, of course, it's not a fair choice. It's a very powerful rag. Suppose you had taken a rag like Chayanat, or, you know. But I was very interested that Khan Sahib thought that there are, you know, rasas that can be evoked. Now, my problem has been this, that it is given and it's undeniable that music, even one note intoned against a tanpura, can touch you. Yeah. It evokes some emotion. But does that therefore warrant evoking the theory of rasa? Mm. That is my question. And I'm still not sure. I don't want to say no. I don't want to say yes. But from your demonstration, I think if some practicing musician, a great musician like Khan Sahib, has thought that in Shri, in a rag, there are different places where different rasas can be evoked. Now, as I said earlier also, rasa is a very specific technical idea. It is not just the idea of an emotion. Mm. Of course, emotions are evoked with any kind of music, not just raga. If you take a Western Mozart or anything, of course emotions are evoked. But does that, what do we mean by trying to evoke the idea of the theory of rasa? And I'm still open about it, and I think a discussion on this, in what sense does rasa, beyond the idea of an emotion or a bhava, how is that relevant in, say, raga music? You speak of the augmented fourth and the fifth and the dissonances, right? The third, the ga, Shuddha Gandhara, in Western theory, for instance, is supposed to be a happy note. Whereas I do know that Kishori Tai, she said that the Shuddha Gandhara evokes Karuna. She does that. Now, what do you mean by saying it evokes Karuna? In a rag like Yaman, I think the way you approach the Gandhara, it could evoke Karuna. So, but I am really concerned whether this warrants evoking the theory of rasa as articulated by Bharata and commented upon in the tradition of Alankara Shastra. That is a more specialized theory.
But we have to also keep in mind that Bharata's, if you take Bharata's words, you cannot see nritya producing rasa. So you have to.
That's what you have to keep in mind.
Because when you see a flower, there is no rasa, it's a beauty that you see. But when you produce like Ram Gopal and get out the fragrance, then you are producing rasa.
Bharata doesn't speak of rasa in music, does he?
In dance, of course he does.
No, in music.
In music, at the end you do.
Really?
No, actually there's a tradition who eats swara. They say it's associated with the swara.
Yeah,
all those.
Associated with shringara. I don't know what to make of it.
I think one of the questions that we have to nail down is what is it that prevents the association of rasa theory with music?
Yes. Yeah. I don't think so.
That's the central question. And my feeling on this is that essentially when we're listening to a piece of music that touches us, we're experiencing it through the spectrum of our own experience, right? Through the spectrum of our own history. So, I mean, one of the most kind of assumed experiments about music is that if you play Indian music for people outside of the culture, especially in the West, things that make us happy don't necessarily make others happy, right? And things that make us sad don't necessarily make others sad. So what is it that's making, what's the association of Yaman with Shantarasa? What is that? Is that cultural? Is that something that we experience through the spectrum of our own experience, right? So in that sense, when we talk about rasa theory, is an explicit story, an explicit situation, an explicit scenario required, or is our own personal experience sufficient to produce a rasa theory? Mm-hmm. I think that's the central question, and that's what I think we should be looking at in order to understand.
I think that was also the question you raised earlier, whether everybody receives a performance in the same.
And I think we all agree that some kind of knowledge about what you are seeing, at least your ears or your eyes should be accustomed to what is happening. Yeah. Otherwise, as you said, to an ordinary Western audience, it may not resonate the way it does.
But it may resonate in a whole different way. And the question is really, is one experience more valid than the other? And I don't.
No, I don't have any answer to that. No, yeah. But the other thing we do remember that Shanta is not part of Bharata.
Correct. Yeah. Yes.
So So Yaman is much better, later, right?
Well, the association of Shantarasa with Yaman is much later.
Yes, yeah. I mean, Shantarasa didn't used to exist.
Yeah. I would just like to come back as an artist point of view when you said, is this discussion important for us to have to do today and for further study? I feel it is very important as a reminder for us as artists to go back to our texts, because we practice, we learn the text for the time that we are with our gurus, for the reasons of, I'm just going to talk about being born and brought up in Bombay, how parallel educations were happening in academic as well as in dance, and we were learning rasa theory for studying it, writing our papers. Then it came to a point where we started understanding it, at least touching on the surface, at least beginning to understand. The study of human emotions, the study of observing, the study of looking at people in a different point of view, so that we could see those human emotions and try to bring them back through our practice. But this journey of going back to the text, coming back to the practice, going back, visiting, coming back, is very important as a performer. For us to be reminded of what the text says, and for us to know, oh yes, that is how, this is how I feel, this is the sthayi bhav. When I am presenting khandita, do I really need to meet somebody who is khandit? But have I really met somebody who has khandit? What are the expressions on that person's face? Then how do I bring those in me? And then what the text says. It is this amalgamation. It's a journey. It's something that we, as artists, I feel, it needs to be touched on. The actual observation of humans, their behaviors, their gestures, the text that presents this, because the text, it's not that Bharata created emotions. It is a study of humans. And then writing it down, noting it in a certain way, and then structuring it. So for us to understand that, it's important that we get into the practice of observing, go back to our texts, correlate it, bring it back to practice, see if it can be created, go back to observing. This is, as a dance teacher, it is very important. How do I make it relevant to my students in Canada when I want to tell them khandita, where the girl is going to be? Why would I be khandit if my husband is cheating on me? How do I relate that to make them understand that rasa behind it, and for them to invoke that rasa in them and in the audience? Because the audience sitting here is also the Canadian audience, who's going to be, why would that girl be so sad? But to leave with feeling that sadness, feeling the emotions that the khandita is presenting in you, to feel. So those gestures that the girl would use, it is important for me to know those gestures, those mudras, and then, so going back and forth with the text. And so this is, I believe it's a fantastic dialogue, because this dialogue will continue in my practice when I'm teaching. And I think this was, again, it's very important for us, because we leave the connection after a certain period of time. It's important to go back. I opened my books. I looked into the rasa theory. I made sure I knew a little bit more. And do I know a little bit more than what I was when I was a student? Oh, yes, maybe. I could understand a little bit more of what Dr. Bose said today than what I was. So I know there are students here. I know Sudnya students are sitting there taking down notes. 10 years, 20 years down the line, if this dialogue continues, the place where they reach at that point is going to be probably far better than where we are reached right now.
I thank you, but I want to make two comments. One is the whole idea is to anukaran, to imitate. So that's why all these rasas, these bhavas are there, to imitate. Absolutely. And this is to teach to people who had no access, like women and shudras. They didn't have access to Vedas. So through, they couldn't read the Vedas, so through anukarana, through natya, we learn. That's the idea. And this is another point that all of you should remember, the dancers. The word for hand gesture is not mudra, it's hasta. Mudra is for rahasya mudra, which are used in tantric how it has come to be used by the dancers, I have no idea. But if you follow Bharata or all the dance writers, nobody writes mudra. Only Vishnu Dharmattara Purana, when it's done for religious purpose, then it's mudra. Otherwise, it's hastra.
And that's where the whole, as I said, the text sometimes do come in, help us to teach a lot. And with your note as well, observation, observation, observation. You know, when we go to buy a house, a realtor says, it's always a location, location, location. I think for dancers, it is observation, observation, observation. Going back, even observing your own texts carefully, because your experience is going to teach you more again. The same word could be expressed in a different way. So
with that, I think, do we have any more questions that we could do? Because we are running out of time, right? Alkhil, tell me, am I doing all right?
Yes.
Okay, good.
So in Chidambaram, South India, in Tamil Nadu, there's this whole temple.
That's
I forget
right.
When it was built, maybe 8th, 9th century. Dedicated to Bharata,
and the, all the
with the dance
all
poses,
these sculptures there.
Exactly.
Not only there, but you have in Brihadishwara.
Correct.
And Shargapani.
Correct.
These
yeah.
three.
That's right. But today, mostly it's the Chidambaram temple that's still associated. For instance, you still have dance performances there. So, can you speak to what role integrating these knowledge into temple architecture? What role did it play? Was it to educate a broader public? Was it to make them aware constantly of the principles behind Nāṭyaśāstra? What was it?
That's a good question. But by then, when these were built, these temples were built, already we had the Devadasi system introduced. And those were done in the temples. Bharata never thought of doing it only in temples. When he suggested the stage building, he never mentioned it to be held in the temples. It came much later, the temple. It was religious purpose, so always gods are included. But when that started to happen, those are for, you know, to educate ordinary people so that they can follow what is being done. And also it's an offering. Sculptures.
Yeah, could it also be to, from this was something new, this was a takeaway for me, I didn't know this, that Bharata intended this to be a way of educating the women and the Shudras for whom the sacred knowledge was
not available.
So could it be that society by then, I don't know what stage the caste system was, but Devadasis were looked down upon and this was meant to be a sacred space for them to be integrated back? Could that be a narrative?
Well, actually, you are right. By that time, the Devadasis were kind of looked down upon. But to begin with, that was not the case. And there are three types of Dasis. One meant for Devadasi. One Alankara Dasi. They were all trained in dance. Alankara Dasis were meant for court. And Rajadasi was meant, they were meant for, Alankari Dasi meant for public. So, but the training for the Devadasis were, you know, directed towards Nāṭyaśāstra, and so they were not looked down upon inside the temple. They were looked upon because of their,
right.
You know,
so
they
that
were,
is my question. If this was to be an integrating space, coming back to Bharata's original mission of, you know, after all, if these were meant for women and these women were again being excluded.
Yeah.
So could it be a space
we are,
for integrating
the actors should be women. Every single text, who is a dancer? So the body of a woman was described in each and every text. Not a single man, male dancer ever was. So you see all the Karanas. Women dancers, not one male figure. There are so many things to answer, you know, sort of ask and answer.
Any other questions? No one?
I think everybody's tired.
Yeah.
I'm hungry. This question is based on like the scope of the musician versus the scope of a raga. I've seen a lot of veteran musicians discuss about this. So they say that in general, there's one particular sect which says no matter what, a particular rasa will dominate a raga. And others say it depends on how the presenter is presenting. For example, if we take a raga like Charukesi, most of them associate it with agonized bhakti, but musicians do argue that if you want, you can always present it in terms of Raudra Rasa or Veera Rasa. It totally depends on the musician. And the presenting style in turn will always affect the perception. And it's not about one dominating Rasa. Is this true? Is there a conclusion for this particular debate?
In my experience, a raga has certain affinities to rasa, but from my perspective, a raga is like a personality. It's like meeting a person, and you know, people come in all types. There are happy people, sad people, angry people, depressed people, whatever. There's people of all sorts, but people are capable of experiencing and emoting anything, right? So from my personal experience, a raga has an overriding affinity towards a rasa, but it does not mean that's the only rasa that can come out of it. That's been my experience.
You know, again, if you have a potent raga like Shri or Thodi, you know, with the flat notes, Komal Swaras, you know, in general are, I think, you know, very closely associated with certain rasas. If we must talk of rasa, as I said, for me, the jury is still out whether we should talk of rasa in the context of raga presentation. I'm happier talking just of the raga. But, you know, say in Shankarabharanam, for instance, a Carnatic raga, you know, what rasa do you want to talk about in that context? Is there a need, first of all, and can you justify it? Or Kalyani? I'm struggling with that question, really, because as I said, notes and some notes, you know, if you have a sa and you sing the Komal Rishab, it gives a certain restlessness. Even it's acknowledged in Western theory, the flat sixth coming to the fifth, it creates a certain restlessness. It'll create a certain thing. But raga is complex enough. It has its own, it's a world of its own, of course very much connected with the world of emotions. Otherwise there's no point in engaging with raga. If it is not emotive, if it doesn't have emotional content, if it doesn't evoke emotion in the audience, there's no point. But whether we can talk specifically of, you know, Karuna or Veera or Raudra Rasa in the context of raga, whether we can, whether it's necessary, I'm still thinking about it.
I do remember, several years before we started recording everything that Baba was teaching, he sat down and he said, I'm going to demonstrate all of the rasas in Rag Bhairavi, in Sind Bhairavi. He said, except Bibhats, which is what? Disgust. But then another time someone said he told them a story after, sometime after that, and he said, my father once played Puriya in such a way, he was given 15 minutes to demonstrate, to play in between all the other great musicians, and to show that he had something exceptional, he sat down and played Puriya, and he made them all sick. Now that's, Sangeet is full of apocrypha, but there is that story that you could actually create bibhats with Puriya if you did it badly enough or something. But Baba actually did sit down and show how you can alter the way you approach the notes, and how much gamak you use, how much andolin, and what notes you use in Sind Bhairavi. And it is a very multifarious raga, and you can hear everything in it, really. And he demonstrated that. But it is a difficult question, because is there meaning in music? Sometimes a musician will have a programmatic idea of a rasa. One musician once described Bhatiyar as a beautiful morning
on a marsh with the sun shining through the marshes. Some people have a programmatic idea, but mostly it's abstract. And so there is a problem. But I think it's worth pursuing.
Yes,
yeah, definitely. And I definitely think rasa when I'm practicing and when I'm studying, because that's what Bappa told us to do. Think rasa and try to emote something through your music.
I think we have time for one more question, Arno. Would you like to come up? We also, during the lunchtime, you'll also get a chance to kind of network with the panelists and ask them questions there. So if you don't have time to do it now, you can do it in person later.
Thank you. It has been really enriching conversation. I was just wondering if Dr. Bose and others can help me understand the, of course, idea of rasa. It was fascinating for me to know as a dancer that nritya by Bharata is, the abstract nritya is not, there shouldn't be any rasa there. And I was just thinking in the modern presentation of classical, Indian classical dance, do you think it is more of influence of the bhakti movement that we have, even in music, that the rasa is, the constant rasa is more like a devotion. Sringara is also a part of, like, you know, so even when we are doing the abstract dances, you might understand the adavus, we are actually thinking of a rasa, and in general, it's more like the joy or devotion, whichever probably comes easier. So maybe, is it because, it's a question for Dr. Bose, that during Bharata, the bhakti movement, or they were not formalized yet. And when the modern contemporary Indian classical dance formated, there was, the bhakti movement was already there. So maybe from there we took the abstract dance to have a constant rasa. Is there a connection there?
I would agree with you there, and I think Akhil also brought it up about bhakti rasa. Mm-hmm. When Bharata wrote that book, there is no bhakti rasa acknowledged. And from first century on, there was this bhakti thing. Still, it did not penetrate all the shastras. So up to 10th century, you would not find 10th. And from around 11th century, Manasallas and then Someshwara Deva, they started talking about this attaching some kind of after effect of nritya. When you see a beautiful flower, you enjoy the beautiful flower. You don't have to smell it. The fragrance is not necessary, only looking at it. Is this rasa? And then the idea of bhakti rasa, santa rasa, these are later development. So if we take Bharata, yes, nritya has no meaning. But the evolution teaches us that we could add some kind of emotive experience when we look at a beautiful thing. But the idea is that as you offer flower, there is no meaning to it. But if you dance to a song, then it's definitely you want to. So you are right that bhakti came later. So that's why you, in Gita Govinda, you see all the dances and all the so-called modern classical dances from 17th, 18th century on, you do find that bhakti rasa has actually affected the expressions and everything. So.
And just to take it from, does it have any effect on music also in terms of, because I have no idea about that. Like
I'll ask you to, why don't you say bhakti? How does it influence?
I don't think I ever studied a raga that Bala didn't say that was bhakti rasa in this raga. But especially the pure ragas, like Yeman, Malkons, even Sri, they all have bhakti. And I mean, it's a really major dominant
Bhakti is a major dominant, yeah. I think, for modern day dance or music.
You won't need it in all ragas. You probably don't need bhakti in Manj Kamaj, because it's so romantic and joyful. But in many ragas, there's a bhakti.
This brings to mind, there was the Madras Music Festival, and I had a Westerner who was totally unexposed to Indian music, and he was attending the concerts with me. And of course, he was totally agnostic and so on. At the end of the concert, he said, well, I do believe, I understand why India is the land of the gods. A singer cannot sing like that unless the singer feels that he or she is singing for the gods and with the gods. So maybe that partially answers your question.
No. I think we should. We have all listened to our talk. Probably everybody is now ready to take a break.
Yes. I would just like to thank all the panelists for a wonderful discussion. And I would like to invite Dr. Anne Murphy to come up. And on behalf of ICMSV, Ashta Lines, and Caesar to present a token of our appreciation to all the panelists.
Good heavens.
Thomas G, thank you so much.
Thanks so much. Good event. Sweet thing. And we will also have volunteers to direct you there after the lunch.